didn't shoot anybody, no, sir.
There's only one thing that I can tell you, that this case is cinched, that this man killed the president. There's no question in my mind about it.
Is there any indication that this was an organized plot, or was it just one man?
There's no one else but him.
Are there any other suspects linked with Oswald?
No.
Once the government announced that it had been done by a lone assassin, the media in assembled ranks without an exception adopted this and viciously attacked anybody who raised any questions at all.
Mort always did say that he thought every single fact about the investigation or the assassination of the president should be open, should be given to the public, no matter what it is, you know, just let the chips fall where they may. But every single thing should be told to the public.
At that time, I actually read the Warren Report on the stage, and I read the more ludicrous aspects of it. In other words, I held up a picture of Oswald being shot by Ruby. What do you say to the audience is funny? How did Ruby get in to shoot him? No, you say, here's a photo of Oswald being shot while he was being guarded by 123 members of the Dallas Police Force, or 124 if we count Ruby. That's the way you do it. Or you read the testimony.
He read some things from the Warren Report. He made fun of them, and they were funny. There were some funny things said. But I got to a point where every time I'd hear Kennedy's name mentioned when he was on stage, I'd just freeze up because I knew the people were saying, oh, God, here he goes with the Kennedys again, you know.
I mean, all of a sudden, you've got this guy who gained a worldwide reputation for being controversial. He gets involved with an investigation with Jim Garrison on the assassination, and all of a sudden, everybody's saying, you better stay away from that guy because that guy is really run amok. He and Garrison have run amok. They're so involved in that case that Mort is not funny anymore. He's just not funny. But of course, that was hard to believe because he was as funny as ever.
Bill Moyers, he says, Warren is my guy over there. I said, how do you think history will remember Warren? You know, what decision? He says, I think for the job he did in Dallas. So I said, you mean a Warren Commission? He says, yes, wasn't that terrific? Did you read it? I said, yeah, I read it. He says, did you like it? Now we're talking about, you know, as one would discuss any other work of fiction. So I said, sure. I said, no, I didn't like it. He says, what part didn't you like? I said, I didn't believe it. So he starts to laugh. He says, ha, ha, I suppose you're one of those conspiracy guys. So I said, yeah, ha, 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 you know.
There is no truth to the rumor, however. I can assure you that there's a sign inside the CIA building that says, be careful of the government you overthrow. It may be your own.
He was like a dog with a bone because he was outraged and he was incensed and he couldn't in his heart understand why people just wanted to let it go. I think he was shocked not only at what happened, as the rest of us were, but at how many people, in the name of wanting to put it behind us, turned vicious towards the people that didn't. That's probably a national psychosis that we subscribe to. And Mort runs, treads the delicate line between entertaining and informing. He's not exactly a Jeremiah, but he is a person who tries to hold up a mirror. And I think people tend to resent it. We're cultural amnesiacs. We don't like news to hang on. He's been a victim of the times in that regard.
I've always said that in a real sense, Mort Sahl probably paid a higher price than all the rest of us involved with the investigation. Because I know it cost him jobs, it cost him money, they attacked his reputation, he had to fight back to try to regain his reputation, it affected his career, but no matter what would happen, he would just go on.
He never backed up, he never quit, assume he sweated out a pretty long period.
In 1967, Mort was scheduled to open on Broadway in a show comprised of sketches and monologues and simply entitled Mort Sahl. A few days before the scheduled opening, the show was canceled. Mort came to San Francisco and held a press conference at the Hungry Eye, where he read from a letter he had written to the show's producer.
I received an order from you by telephone at 3 a.m. Sunday, November 26th, to deliver at 5:30 p.m. that day a finished manuscript for a sketch based upon the findings of the Warren Commission to last for at least 35 minutes. I complied. I did as I was instructed. I was then informed by the director, in your presence, the show has too much material and there were not sufficient stenographic help to type the scripts for distribution to the actors. Therefore, the sketch was dropped from the production at that moment. It was a sketch about the Warren Commission. It was the basis of the Warren Commission and the media and how the president's death was investigated by the Warren Commission. And it was based, the entire sketch, I really take no credit for it. It's quoted from the testimony. I thought that'd be good for the audience. It's quoted from the testimony. It is not from me. It's actual government testimony. And it takes place as a kind of three-ring circus. It's in three rings, television, newspapers, and the Warren Commission. And it's kind of fun. In the end of it, we say the torch is passed, and we see a fellow going into the archives with some matches. But that's not typical of the whole show. I want to make one point here, though. I'm not accusing anybody, by the way. I want to make this explicit. I'm not accusing anybody of censoring that sketch. They continued to tell me that they wanted that to be main source. Do a sketch in a Warren Commission. Do a sketch. They kept requesting it.
What is your personal feeling about Jim Garrison?
Yes. What is my personal feeling? Well, he's a friend of mine, you know. And he's a good friend of mine. I mean, as a guy, I think that, you know, it's gonna be very tough to resolve anything here because he's got major forces against him. He has Bob Kennedy against him, and he has the president against him, and he has the CIA against him, and he has a portion of the press against him, and he's got the guilt of the American people. It looks rough. I don't think he's got an easy course. If we do believe, though, that the truth is the truth and it must come out, we have to scour our souls, it'll come out.
You act like a man with something on your mind.
Why don't you tell the people the truth for a change?
The truth. The man wants the truth.
The man wants the truth. What is the truth, said jesting Pilate, and would not stay for an answer.
The people of this country pick up their papers and what do they read?
You're an honorary stooge. You ought to be shown up.
Have a drink, Senator?
It'll taste better than the truth.
Hey, Senator, don't let it get you down. 100 years from now, nobody'll know the difference.
They wanted me to go away. I found that when I got to be a movie writer, you know, I'd come in and I'd tell the idea for a movie, and they'd say, all right, why don't I give you $45,000 and you go away and write this? And then his partner would say, why don't we give him $90,000 and just have him go away?
Do you have an agent now?
No, and I can't get one.
No one will handle it?
The last agent I had was Freddie Fields, who was, you know, a very able fellow, creative management. He said to me, no agent can help you in the position you're in.
Did he give you a reason?
He said, there's just too much resistance. There's interference and there's resistance. Those are the words. My agent went to a studio with me for a series a couple of months ago and got the answer, don't bring his name up in this office. He went to one of the three major networks, and the answer was never. Not only never, but an obsessive indication that I was suicidal because of the kind of people I go after and what I say. So the point is that maybe, if I am, maybe I am, I always was. How do we explain the acceptance initially? In other words, you're entitled to any opinion of me except surprise. I hate to say it, but I think this is an intense reaction to a nightclub comedian.
You know what my reward was for my pains? The liberals would write in the paper, he ain't funny anymore.
And well, could it be that you are simply passé, that you've lost the bloom?
I don't think you'll find that by the attendance figures in any of the engagements. But the irony is that you can't go back to work.
Do you think if you changed your material, you'd have better luck?
No, sir. No, sir, because the audience shows no indication. The audience is interested in what's happening. You'll know soon enough if you're not saying what the public wants. There's this vast silence. They're like a jury if you don't reach an audience.
The American people can't hire you. The nightclub owners and the television executives hire you.
Well, that's true. They're the arbiters, but I think you've got to get through to the audience. That's one of the good things about the nightclub business, or it was, I should say, past tense, I suppose. You've got to stay with the people. If you can wait it out, maybe you can beat it. I don't know. I know it sounds illogical, but you've got to raise a flag of hope and a sea of evidence that's against it.
I guess this is just another lost cause, Mr. Payne.
And the harvest of what we found came out repeatedly afterward in Watergate and the Iran-Contra affair. The whole idea of shadow government and of people who think they know better what's good for Americans than what Americans know.
Garrison's investigation culminated in the trial of a man named Clay Shaw, whom the DA charged with conspiring to kill the president. When Shaw was acquitted in March of 1969, there were those who interpreted the verdict as a full vindication of the Warren Report.
I think it was running for cover. I think when the right wing opened up, when they killed Kennedy, when they killed the kids at Kent State, when they reminded everybody they play hardball, everybody ran like they were surprised. And the country began to unravel.
And it's 1, 2, 3, what are we fighting for? Don't ask me, I don't give a damn. The next stop is Vietnam. And it's 5, 6, 7, open up the pearly gates. Well, there ain't no time to wonder why. Woo, we're all gonna die. Now come on, Wall Street, don't be...
This is a great era for demonstrating and picketing. And although the other generation says, in effect, I didn't raise my boy to carry a sign, there they are, and they are everywhere. I was recently on Pennsylvania Avenue in front of the White House, and these are a few of the signs I saw at random. Hitler is alive, dash, dash, in the White House. Make love, not war. War is a basic industry. Invest your son. One fellow had an interesting sign. It was a long sign. It was tall, and it said, Hubert Humphrey has strayed from his original commitment as a liberal and as a founding father of the ADA, and by merchandising a war about which he has no conviction, may have developed into a self-seeking opportunist in the process. That fellow was arrested carrying that sign, and he was charged with passing federal secrets. Students in California march with signs. They say things in Berkeley like, God isn't dead, he just doesn't want to get involved, or tomorrow has been canceled due to a lack of interest, and that sign is signed God. All of this, by the way, will be seen on ABC's Wide World of Sports on Saturday, I imagine. The Columbia University student body versus the New York City police. The winner going to the Riot Bowl in Berkeley, California. This is Mort Sahl in Malibu, California.
That's what I told Mike Wallace. You know, but he refused to ask me what I meant. He said to me, do you think that you were courageous in working on a Kennedy assassination? I said, no, the most courageous act that men embark upon is to love women. He never asked me what I meant.
I live in L.A. all the time now, and so all the girls I go out with are actresses and other female impersonators. And they won't give up. Now, I was out last night, as luck would have it. I don't go out much, you know, because I'm busy saving America. And sometimes I go out. And that's right. The last four girls I went out with fell asleep listening to the Warren Report. That's right.